You put your finger right on it. If it doesn't have an argument, it's not scholarship, okay? As it's valued by promotion and tenure processes, okay? So scholarship is as scholarship is valued. And the article that Will and I did was designed to say, okay, we built a big archive, let's make an argument and see if we can get it through two rounds of peer review and on the cover of the American Historical Review. And very explicitly, and because I was at some meeting, Washington Intervisors whining, no, we don't get promoted for this. I said, we've not done anything to get promoted for, because we've not done what the promotion and tenure process values. Nobody gets promoted for putting together a collection of documents of any sort. You have to make an argument. So I think that the digital teaching, we're only going to get really good stuff in the classroom when we're producing really good digital scholarship rather than just really good teaching materials. And that's where we're not close to. That is the source of my anxiety, is that even when we're doing cool stuff, then we're translating it back into the book form and giving away a lot of the capacity of what the digital media could be. So we're barely trying to create digital scholarship, it seems to me. And until we do, we're going to be blocking our own progress.
Alan, do you want to add one
thing? That as well. This goes back to a question I asked that was Patrick Manning earlier in the day about the concept of simulation and so on that year. I think that what digital scholarship today should be about is experimenting with the notion of scholarship so that we break out of our straight and narrow and historically fairly recent notions of what scholarship consists of. So for example, when I'm sitting at a table with my computer science colleagues and my social science colleagues at the University of California, I can tell you that all the deep and rich analysis or interpretation that I do isn't worth what would be the appropriate cliche here, hell beans or whatever here. For the social scientist, the answer is, well, that analysis of Wordsworth's Prelude is item one in the database. Where are the other 1,000 examples? For the computer scientist, it's not empirical enough, of course, here. So I think we need to begin to experiment with our scholarship so that besides interpreting and analyzing, we do things with other verbs. We build. We experiment, we model, we simulate, and we bring those into configuration with each other with one special extra ingredient that the rest of the builders and experimentalists out there, we use that as their paradigm of knowledge in the workplace, in the private sphere, cannot match. So, you know, Google, for example, is fabulous at experimenting and building, but industry still looks to us as builders and experimenters and simulators, not just of artifacts and products, but of people. Ultimately, what am I building when I build a digital project? Why do I insist that my graduate students do the coding themselves as opposed to bring in outsiders to build a better product for us? I conceive my role in digital scholarship to build a better person. I finished with this because it's such a fabulous anecdote. I was sitting around a seminar table once with Martin Minsky, famous raconteur of the artificial intelligence world with a fabulously prickly personality, especially against all things humanistic. He said to me and others there, all the money that we are throwing away on the humanities and arts every year, you give me that money and in 10 years I will build you a better student. Now, I think that what we are doing is trying to build better students. It just doesn't take the form of the precise kind of building and experimentation and, you know, simulation that the other disciplines are engaging in.